All right, guys, everyone, welcome. Before Dan or Jonathan do their normal intro, Jonathan gave me the opportunity to show off a game that I'm making in Java. My name's Oren, and I work for Pattison with Dan, but in my spare time, I'm a Java game developer. So, hit play. Thank you. Anyway, so tonight we're submitting it to IndieCade, and if we're one of the top 36 games, we get a trip to San Francisco to be at E3. So fingers crossed. Thanks a lot.
Good. All right. Welcome to the March meeting of the Java User Group. We'll just go through our little introduction slide. We got a lot of people here today, so. We're going to go around the room really quickly, just say your name, what you do with Java, and maybe keep notes and, you know, recognize people. And if you see someone you're interested in or hear something you want to talk to them about, meet up with them after, say hello, introduce yourself. Great. Okay, so this is our slide that we post every month, showing you how you can contact us. So we use meetup.com to organize our meetings. So join up there and join our thing. You get all the notices.
Could you raise your voice, please?
Sure. Yep. So you can find us on meetup.com. And if you subscribe to our meetup, then you get notifications, reminders, things like that about what's going on. We video record all of these. So you can find the presentations on our website afterwards. And we have a job posting mailing list as well. So if you have a job to post, or if you're looking for jobs in the GTA, you can go and check that out. We're partnering with O'Reilly, and we have this code that you can use to get 40% off all the O'Reilly ebooks. So definitely check that out if you're looking for books. And you can find this in the video or our slides later if you want, but it's PCBW. All right, and some Java news. This first news item isn't exactly Java, but it's related to the whole industry and does kind of relate. But there's a big explosion with NPM and JavaScript packages over the last week, where a whole bunch of critical packages were removed suddenly from their shared repository. And it broke a lot of builds. So they've made some changes to the system, and they lock builds that have been around for a while, so things can't be arbitrarily removed. But it was kind of scary and surprised a lot of people and made a lot of people unable to work. And so it relates to Java a little bit, because we also use shared repositories of dependencies in tools like Ivy and Maven. And I'm not sure what the repercussions would be if Maven Central suddenly removed a whole bunch of critical projects. But I think it would probably...
At least we have them in our .m2.
Yeah, you do have a local copy. We have, if you run a local mirror, then you'll have some copies of it at your business, but.
You could also fail over to JCenter.
Yep.
But probably after that.
It'd be a big problem.
It'd be bad.
What is it? Maybe it just allow you to take something down.
No, it doesn't. It's like JSON events out will like SSH in there and delete stuff for you.
Yep.
Well,
it
wouldn't
be
in your
It's open source.
Right.
threat. Yeah.
Yeah, hopefully.
Yeah, in this case, it was a legal threat, and they were just like, oh my god, take everything down. And
sorry, actually, just because I was following it, what happened was there was a legal threat against one package.
Right, and there was a cascade.
Kick.
Yeah.
No, and the guy who published that package basically had a hissy fit and decided to unpublish everything else that he had published.
Oh, no. Right.
Yeah, so it was actually the author specifically who took it all down.
Took all of his stuff.
Well, that's, you know, that's his decision, I guess.
Yep. So that was exciting anyway. Our usual Java problems with Oracle are back. They're putting new, I guess you might want to call it malware, into the consumer JRE installer, various toolbars and everything else. And now it has this privilege escalation dialog that looks kind of scary on OS X. Ask you for your password, and the installation instructions just say, oh yeah, enter an administrator password, and everything will be fine. But it never doesn't say what it's going to do other than install a helper tool, which is probably scary. If you download the JDK packages, the developer packages from Oracle, you're totally safe, and they don't bundle that kind of stuff with it. But it's got privacy implications. They install like browser toolbars that send all of your searches to ask.com and other weird stuff that's completely unrelated to Java. They are. it's not a good practice. Nobody in the Java community really likes it, but they do it anyway, and it's been going on for years.
For Windows a lot.
Windows and now OS X, and not Linux yet, as far as I know, but I'm sure they're figuring it out. So minor Java update. There's Java 8 update 77, which includes a new time zone database and a security fix for the browser plugin that nobody should have installed or be running. So don't use applets. Don't use the browser plugin. But if you are, definitely update, because anybody with a website can run code on your computer. A little bit more Oracle news. It's a good Oracle news month, really. The FTC has ruled against Oracle with their installer practices and leaving old versions of Java sitting around on your computer. They feel that it's a security problem, and Oracle needs to identify that it's leaving stuff behind and be honest with the consumers, because they talk about it being safe and secure, and it really isn't, especially if you have vulnerable versions. You think you upgraded, there may still be old code sitting around. So they have to fix their installer and be more honest. And another Oracle slide. So Oracle thinks that its copyright problems with Google were worth $8.8 billion in damages, leading to another few years in court, I'm sure. And Google disagrees. They don't think it's $8.8 billion. They probably think it's less. And they're going to fight for that. So it's going to be quite interesting to see how that number changes over time. Yet another Oracle slide. I didn't actually realize this when I was building it, that it was all Oracle. So this person's a fairly active Java evangelist, and felt that leaving his post at Oracle was the best thing he could do for the Java community, and would let him support Java the best. So I thought that was kind of interesting. This was actually on a blog on Oracle's website, this statement. And I thought it was amazing that it was left there. He just wanted to forward his career. He never gave us, like, there's no smoking gun that he identified, but it was a fairly... Yeah, he never really talked about it.
Probably working for Oracle
is one of them. Taking the job in the first place? Yeah. So, all right, and I guess another Oracle one. Brian Getz having fun on Twitter with people who are complaining... or just commenting on another one of his posts, but he's fairly snarky.
He is.
And it gives some insight on the Java feature selection process. Yes. This is official from Oracle, right?
is that Monte Carlo or Las Vegas?
Yeah. All right. So that's all the news I've got this month. Does anybody else have anything interesting, exciting new Java stories, new releases of software?
I
want to highlight anything like that? Nope. Okay. Well, I'm going to hand it over to Marius for his presentation on microservices and Spring Cloud. And yeah, everybody have a great evening.
All right.
So hello, everyone. Can you hear me all too well? We need to raise my voice, let me know. First, thanks a lot for having me here and actually being back in Toronto. My name is Marius Bogoevici. I work for Pivotal. I'm part of the Spring team, where I lead one of the projects that we're going to talk about tonight, which is called Spring Cloud Stream. It's our framework for developing event-driven microservices, which is basically why the title is advertised. It's event-driven microservices with Spring Cloud. We're going to talk about how many of you are familiar with the Spring Cloud family of projects? Quite a few, right? You should. Like, I think Jonathan has talked about it in one of the past editions, so should have paid attention. And what I'm going to talk about is one of the, like, two of the newest projects there, which are Spring Cloud Stream and Spring Cloud Data Flow. Spring Cloud Stream deals with building event-driven microservices, as I said. Spring Cloud Data Flow is dealing mostly with orchestrating and deploying them over different platforms. So it's kind of I think it's going to be quite interesting. We're going to do some demos. We're going to build some of these microservices, so you'll see exactly how it works. And first, the domain problem, right? Stream processing. You're familiar with it. How many of you have encountered it, worked directly with it? What are you using?
Spark.
Spark. Yeah. Spark Stream, I suppose. Yeah.
I've used Storm in the past.
Right. Storm, yeah. Storm is definitely one of the popular frameworks and platforms. That's fine. I'm fine. I'm gonna steal this chair when I do the demo, but it's okay. So yeah, Storm is a good example for the type of problem that stream processing is trying to solve. One of the motivations for these projects is basically that in the modern world, data streaming and building microservices that interact in an event-driven fashion they're not really different problems. There is some convergence right now between, let's say, the world of big data and the world of more traditional applications. And event-driven microservices is one of these convergence points. And in terms of use cases, you'll recognize quite a few there. Predictive maintenance, fraud detection, quality of service measurement, log analysis. And all of them have in common the need of processing large amounts of data, but with low latency. So there is kind of a tension there between the high throughput and the low latency of the problem. And this type of processing has traditionally been the realm of batch processing in general, right? But a few things happened. The technology has evolved. Business requirements have evolved. So right now, we can store and process, and we have the computing power to actually analyze large quantities of data very fast, right? So if some decades ago it was, for example, acceptable to detect a fraudulent transaction the next day or when you basically got to look at the entire batch of transactions, right now, there is an expectation that you do it in real time. The other thing that these types of applications have, that's very specific for these types of applications, is that they typically rely on grouping and ordering of data. So, for example, if I'm looking at the data from a sensor, and I want to understand whether the device is failing or not, the way data has fluctuated, the order in which the readings are processed, the order in which I'm looking at the readings is actually quite relevant. Grouping, of course, we want to process, like even if we process this data in a distributed type of scenario, we want data that relates to the specific device, for example, to a specific sensor, to a specific credit card number, to be processed on the same node. We want to see all the data that belong that is related at the same time. Other types of typical scenarios here are windowing, for example. We really want to see, like we process data, for example, it is relevant how the data has evolved over the past minute, over the past 5 minutes, sliding windows, right? Like a 5 minute, for example, a 5 minute window of data sliding over with a step of 1 minute. Partitioning, for example, is part of this grouping scenario. We want, as I said, to send related data to the same processing node. In terms of running platforms, there is, obviously, when we process such large quantities of data, we really start thinking about like that traditional, let's say, architectures are the model starts to fail. We really rely on, we start relying on distributed processing. We rely on, it happens for a number of reasons. On one hand, for example, is that we require massive computing power, right? We want to distribute the load over a few machines. The other reason why you really end up doing this type of distributed processing is simply because the network interfaces don't hold that amount of throughput, right? You really have to, like if you talk about processing hundreds of gigs of data per second, and it is a requirement that we've seen, you really need to spread it out. Like you're gonna saturate the network interface with that amount of data. So you have to distribute, you have to work like that. Obviously when you have these requirements for storage, for computing power, for scalability, you start thinking about running distributed systems, and again, the do-it-yourself model there starts failing. In terms of a running platform, instead of relying on your ability of actually writing this type of thing, you start relying on the native resource management abilities of various target platforms. So for example, because what we have seen right now is basically that there are different platforms with different with varying capabilities, ranging from essentially simple cluster management like just resource allocation to the ability of actually like incorporating resilience, guaranteeing a number of running instances, failover, and this is basically something that. As I say, you have a wide range of platforms that already do that for you with different degrees of capabilities, right? And you have full application platforms, right? For example, it's Cloud Foundry, right? From Pivotal, obviously. And of course, like mentioned, OpenShift from Red Hat is another one, right? So at the other like cluster managers like YARN or Mesos or Kubernetes do that kind of work for you. So our thinking here was that what we want is to write a platform that's able to target and deploy these types of platforms transparently and use their capabilities to run these high throughput, low latency stream processing applications. And finally, we're getting to microservices, which is basically a word that you probably have heard it a few times today already in different kinds of contexts, right? Who hasn't heard of microservices? I don't think there's anyone, right? And I don't want to dig into the pros and cons of them, and then there is an entire literature and discussion about them. What I want to talk about is in the specific context of data processing. The microservice model fits very well the distribution, the distributed model that we expect for streaming apps. it obviously brings the typical benefits like agility, scalability, ability to deploy, to scale, failover that you get by running them. Like when you combine them with target platforms as the ones that I mentioned, you get these you get all these benefits. Operational control is one of them, the ability to deploy. And apart from that, there are some other specific benefits for data processing, which are things like tuning the process-specific resources. Like all these platforms that I mentioned have, to some degree or another, the ability to allocate different, like and cap the resources that are allocated to the different running processes. So for example, high like applications that require, like they are computing intensive, require more CPU, right? So I don't know, a platform like Mesos, for example, or Kubernetes, or Foundry, for example, you can require more CPU for your application. Or you can require more memory if you, for example, have a data enrichment scenario where you actually require to hold a very large data cache. So this ability of tuning process-specific resources comes to shine when we actually talk about microservices as independent development units and independent deployment units. This is why they are so attractive to us. In terms of interaction, the microservices that we are looking at are not necessarily, let's say, the traditional ones that, let's say, HTTP based, right? A talks to B, point to point, and so on and so forth. We're really looking at event-driven microservices. There are a few benefits there. First is obviously the decoupling that happens, like the temporal decoupling, the physical decoupling between the two components that interact with each other. There's also a benefit that's coming from ensuring data consistency. Event-driven microservices, for example, and eventual consistency are a very good alternative to one of the typical problems of distributed systems, which is distributed transaction management. When A talks to B, and basically A wants to know that B has updated the value, right? You can either do a distributed transaction and ensure that both have actually done their job and synchronize between the two, or you can have A pass B a message, and then indeed, after A has sent the message, it doesn't necessarily know that B has updated itself, but that's no problem. B can actually, it has a guarantee that B will eventually process the message and will get in sync. So what are the kind of experience that we are looking for, right? And I'm going to start with kind of the finite product, and then we'll go and see how exactly it's built out of its parts. So I'm going to run a example running Spring Cloud Dataflow. Spring Cloud Dataflow, as I say, it's the orchestrating platform for for microservice-based in this case streaming applications. It can also orchestrate tasks like short-lived applications. Think batch processing, for that matter. So you can describe, for example, your stream as a sequence of processing, of modules that talk to each other over a pipeline. And the pipeline can be basically any messaging system. In this case, it's going to be Redis, but we actually support Rabbit or Kafka. And for example, there is another implementation right now that supports Gemfi, right? Others are asking for JMS and Kinesis, right? So the ecosystem grows. But that's a completely different type of concern. So let me start this example very quickly. I'm going to make sure that Redis runs. And I already have. I'm going to start the Dataflow server. Dataflow server is basically a Spring Boot application. And I'm going to start the other one of the other components that controls it, which is the shell. Which is another Spring Boot application. Okay. It has connected, so right now I'm going to create a stream. I'm going to call it demo. And I'm going to enter its definition, right? And what this stream does, like the definition here, is basically receiving data on an HTTP endpoint and writing it to a file. Now, this is one of the simplest examples of ingestion that you can imagine, right? And I'm going to do just that. I'm going to make it a little bit more complicated for the example because I want to control the port that I'm running on. I'm going to call it temp demo. Okay. And I'm going to deploy the stream. And a few things happen. When I deploy the stream, the server will basically launch two applications. And I can see that when I'm looking at JPS here, you can see these two different running jars, the file sync and the HTTP source. Like, we call the first module in a stream a source because it's a source of data, and we call the last module a sync because basically this is where data really ends. So these are two running applications, completely independent. How many of you are familiar with Spring Boot? Cool. So these are really Spring Boot applications that the Dataflow server coordinates. So let me just do something. Let me just clear. I have some data from an earlier trial, so I'm going to clear it. And let's actually send some data to the HTTP endpoint. So I'm going to post to the target, which is HTTP localhost 9000. And I'm going to call data hello Toronto. I'm going to have to put some quote marks because. Okay, so what happened was the data has been sent, it has been accepted by the HTTP endpoint, so I'm expecting it to see it on in the output file. So indeed, if I tail the demo folder, I see that, and you see that I have nothing out on my sleeve, I'm going to say hello again, Toronto. And the data has arrived into the target file. And I think that's actually pretty cool. It doesn't show much about what's happening under the scenes, but it gives you an idea that there is some degree, like there are two, like what you should remember from this example is there are two running applications, they are coordinated, they are talking to each other over a messaging system. And you can actually build some very sophisticated pipelines from this type of application, right? And what we're going to talk next is kind of dig into the inside and see what these applications are actually built of. And then we're going to talk later about how they are coordinated. So I'm going to let this run for, actually, let me destroy the stream for now. So the building blocks here, the main building block, these applications are built using Spring Cloud Stream, which is, as I said, our event-driven microservice framework. And the idea was that we wanted to leverage what we already had, which is projects like Spring Boot, for example, that allows you to build microservices, right? Build full standalone applications, Uber jar supports, applications that contain all their dependencies, including the including even the web server, the servlet container, if you want. And then we wanted to also leverage the support that Spring Integration provides in terms of enterprise application integration pattern supports and the enterprise connectors. How many of you are familiar with Spring Integration? So Spring Integration is one of the Spring projects that really focuses on implementing the enterprise integration patterns, like kind of the classic enterprise integration patterns.
Are you allowed to say camel book?
Actually, it's interesting because, it's camel has been the first enterprise integration pattern, let's say, project. And it was Spring-based, mm-hmm. right? But there are some subtle differences, and it followed a different type of approach. We can dig actually into that.
There was the Apache book with the camel on the cover called Enterprise Integration Patterns.
Oh, no, I'm talking about the Gregor Hope and the...
the Apache project?
No, I was talking about the Apache project, but I wasn't actually talking about the O'Reilly book.
Okay.
I was talking about the book from the... Let me just... I'm talking about this.
Yeah. Yeah, there was a Perl camel book.
I'm talking about this.
Oh, that one. Okay.
So, it's one of the Martin Fowler signature books, and it made a big splash in around 2003 when it came out, because it kind of systematically addressed all the patterns of like how different independent applications communicate between each other and basically what are the main patterns that arise in these types of applications, right? So it's been kind of the groundwork for messaging solutions. And Spring Integration was actually the project that tried to implement them using completely Spring constructs. And one of the reasons why we found obviously Spring Integration is a very powerful framework. It already has, besides implementing the patterns, besides implementing some very sophisticated interaction models like routing, the router, the scatter gatter, the aggregator, for example, splitter, like all these types of things that you would kind of expect to come out of the box, is actually supports a wide range of adapters for various enterprise systems, like from JDBC databases to Mongo to Cassandra to whatever you can imagine, really. It's very, very sophisticated. So there is an immense wealth to be used there. And what we wanted was to make it easy to write this type of application, to be middleware agnostic. So I want to be able to write an application that can, actually to write a number of applications that can talk to each other easily over Kafka, over Rabbit, over any kind of messaging system, and not have to necessarily reason about the nature of the messaging system. And not only write these write them easily, because there is already very powerful Spring boots, for example, support and native support for these types of applications, but to actually implement some of the primitives that we found that we consider to be critical in this type of applications. So I'm going to talk a little bit about how is Spring Cloud Stream opinionated about the things that it does, and how does that make it easier to write a specific type of application, right? So essentially, that's pretty much what it's covered by the this notion of opinionated primitives and pluggable middleware binding APIs. What I really think here is exactly what I mentioned. All these patterns, all these opinionated interaction patterns are consistently implemented across different middlewares. In terms of a model, the way a Spring Cloud Stream application is built is essentially it consists of a message-driven core, completely middleware agnostic, that talks to the outside world through a number of input and output channels. So you declare your channels, and then you just interact with them. And it's the responsibility of the framework to actually instantiate them, inject them into the application, and bind them or connect them to the target middleware. So we have this abstraction, which we call a binder, that does exactly that type of thing. From a high-level perspective, essentially you should have the image like each of these components essentially is like fits any type of pluggable component analogy that you can come, like form circuitry from whatever you want. It has a number of ports, which are the input and output channels, that connect to some shared, what we call a shared destination, which is like you can think of it as a bus. And then you can basically construct pretty sophisticated structure using these self-contained models. The important thing is that each of these applications is essentially a Spring Boot application, right? And of course, they can talk like because the middleware is basically like something like Rabbit or something like Kafka has its own connectors. They can actually talk to even to non-boot applications, right? Any kind of Java application, or they can be even not even be Java applications. If you want to write a Go application, for example, that talks to Kafka, then you can have a Spring Cloud Stream application that talks to Kafka, and they can talk to this other microservice, right? So, in terms of opinionated primitives, what we talk about, one of the critical aspects of Spring Cloud Stream is that it really focuses on publish-subscribe semantics between applications. This is to say that if we have, for example, if we have an application like, in our case, for example, the HTTP source, like an endpoint that receives data from HTTP, it writes to a destination, whatever that means in terms of the target middleware, which we call, for example, raw sensor data. And from there on, all the other applications that connect to the same destination will receive data, like in a publish-subscribe scenario. There is no point-to-point communication. Why is that? First, it promotes decoupling. Second, it makes it very, very easy to expand this type of pipeline. So imagine that we have this scenario where we have, for example, an HTTP endpoint producing raw sensor data that's actually processed by an average calculator that produces like average values, which are further sent to another application that basically calculates the top n values right there, right? Each of them doing some like its own windowing and like windowed calculation, for example. The averages can calculate the averages over the last n seconds or something like that. If we build this type of pipeline, and because of the publish-subscribe nature of the interaction, it's quite easy to connect another module that, for example, takes the raw data and just ingests it into HDFS if we want to do some other processing. For example, using Spark. Or the average data can be actually fed into a fault detection module. They can actually read, they can actually see, monitor the fluctuations and do all kinds of other calculations. So I can expand my architecture very, very easily by the virtue of the built-in publish subscribe semantics. And this is an interesting analogy here that usually we talk about these types of things as like really passive let's say, for example, passive data streaming, sensor data that's fed into. But this type of model actually fits very well even, let's say, more active event-driven, what we call like application. For example, an order processing system that really takes certain actions. Like, for example, on the right, you see such an example. The order module receives the order, it processes it, then sends it to the billing module, which actually processes the billing and does some more with it, and then passes it to the shipping module, which again undertakes certain actions, right? But being able to do this, like to monitor the flow of events that are going to the system and signal different changes into the state, actually allows us to do other things. For example, we can build a rewards module that just monitors the orders and calculates rewards for the users without the need of modifying any of the existing apps. And that's another critical aspect of microservices. You want to be able to write these types of applications without really modifying them, and so on and so forth. And this actually is called, like this is a pattern, for example, called event sourcing, right? You pass, instead of actively executing like an RPC style model of invoking methods or on target system, you're just sending out events that notify that it should change its state, right? So there is a very there are a lot of analogies between, let's say, the big data world, let's say, and the more traditional application data world. And this is where we say that there is a convergence between the two. The other, like the polar opposite of it, the polar opposite requirement is it's fine. Everyone receives data. That's excellent. How do I scale? Because obviously, if I want, for example, the order module and the rewards module to receive data, what happens if I have two instances of the order module? What happens if I want to scale? Obviously, I don't want both of them to receive data, because then I would have to process, like make sure that I don't duplicate and do some other kinds of tricks like that, which is why we introduced the notion of consumer groups. And how many of you are familiar with Kafka? So this is essentially a reflection of the consumer group model, which is kind of applied across other middleware. So we apply consistently in other places. What we want to be able to say is that all the applications which are part of a given consumer group will be in a competing consumer relationship to each other, whereas different consumer groups are in a publish-subscribe relationship to each other. Right, so this allows you to both, like, build, like, both connect the applications, but also scale without duplicating data. The other notion that's kind of important here is that each of these subscriptions is durable. So once these groups are created, implementation-wise, we guarantee that they will keep receiving data. So for example, even all the applications in a group are down, when at least one of them comes up, it will start receiving data again. So it's basically, there is no data loss right there. The third thing that we kind of support out of the box is the notion of partitioning. So as I mentioned earlier, partitioning is required for stateful processing scenarios because imagine again the average processor. If data would randomly go to either one of these two processor instances, it would mean that they can calculate two separate values for a given sensor, and none of them will be actually correct. So by definition, you can actually declare that you can specify that for specific output channels, you can specify that they have a partitioning strategy, and then that will guarantee that data is basically sent to a specific partition that an application can listen to on its input. So you can specify that out of a given, like a specific application instance listens to a specific partition. Right? So that's, again, that's built in into the frame. In terms of programming model, I don't want to spend too much time on this because we're actually going to build it, so we'll see how it works. You declare your ports as interfaces. There are a number of interfaces that come out of the box. And then these interfaces are, like, there is an annotation called enable binding. It's not very visible right now, but I'm going to see it in code. And whenever you do something like that, then the framework actually creates an instance. It creates an instance of the channel. It binds it to whatever middleware it finds on the class path. You have pretty sophisticated strategies of picking up what kind of middleware you want. And then it can either participate, for example, as the input channel of inbound channel adapter, for example, in this case is a Spring integration annotation. It says that data returned by this method is actually sent on the output channel. And the output channel being bound to the middleware is actually sent to the middleware. So in this case, it usually, like an inbound channel adapter has a polar, but we have a built-in polar. Like if you, by default, we have a polar with a frequency of 1 second, we can actually declare whatever polling strategy you want for this type of thing. So this is one of the Spring integration components that you can build. There are others, right? There are event-driven service activators, for example, that can do something similar. And we also have an annotation of our own, Stream Listener. That's actually a little bit that uses the support. So Spring Framework itself has some built-in messaging support for that includes, for example, support for type conversion, very much like almost MVC style. So in this case, we can say that if I receive data that's a string, like if I receive textual data with, for example, like this JSON, right? Greeting hello world, and I specify a content type. The content type is either supported by the middleware, which allows you to talk to external applications, but there is also a built-in mechanism for middlewares that do not support headers like Kafka that allow you to transport specific information about the content. So if the content type is identified as application JSON, then it's able to extract it and populate, for example, an object of the type, let's say, greeting. And we'll actually see how to build something like that immediately. There are different types of out-of-the-box interfaces. So the source, and the source, for example, for one output, the sync for one input, and the processor for one input, one output. But the important thing here is that Spring Cloud Stream essentially supports an arbitrary number of interfaces with an arbitrary number of channels. So you can define whatever input and output channel structure you want. The source, sync, and processor fit really mostly the Spring Cloud data flow model, which is more opinionated in the sense that the streams are linear. But it can actually construct some pretty sophisticated nonlinear structures by declaring different types of input and outputs. And there is, like, obviously, we are very interested in building a pretty solid reactive story. For 1.0, we have support, like, kind of derivative of Spring Cloud Stream being an offshoot of Spring XD. We have support for RX Java, but we're actually for 1.1, we target support for reactive streams, types of like Spring Reactor, and so on and so forth. The SPI itself is very simple. So essentially, it's an interface. So basically, creating your own type of binder, creating your own type of integration with a messaging system is as simple as implementing an interface with two methods. Bind producer, and you tell it, OK, this is the external target that I want to bind to. It's foo. That can be anything. It can be a Kafka topic. or it can be a Rabbit topic exchange. How many of you are familiar with Rabbit? Right, so in this case, it's like if, how many of you work with JMS, for example? Right, so we don't have a JMS binder proper, although it's been kind of been a high demand for it. But imagine that this would be, for example, a JMS topic that you're interacting with. In terms of consumers, you actually have, like, here's an example of binding two different consumers on different consumer groups. So the method, the corresponding method is bind consumer with a nation, a group, channel, and various properties. Right? But you can control different quality of service. And even beyond quality of service things, like for something like Rabbit, for example, you can control whether it has a dead letter queue, or you can control let's say the resilience. You can control the durability of the subscription. You can control the whether messages should be returned to the queue on failure. So it's very not only it actually provides support for connecting, but it actually provides support for configuring very sophisticated resilience patterns there. How it maps, and generally speaking, we try to map on the native middleware support. So for example, in Kafka, it really maps directly. So any destination that we're talking about is essentially a Kafka topic. In Rabbit, it's a little bit more sophisticated. Destinations like producers send, so a destination is basically mapped to a topic exchange. But then each consumer group is basically bound to a queue connected to that topic exchange. Right? So this kind of ensures that each group receives both groups receive all the messages, but groups are in competing consumer relationship with each other, right? So that being said, let's see a little bit how it actually works in practice. I want to build a couple of examples and basically kind of give you a better feel of what we're talking about here. So one of the nice things of, and one of the consequences of being Spring Boot based, for example, is that it's really easy to use Spring Initializer or the Spring Starter. So if I'm using, I'm normally programming actually in IntelliJ, but because Spring Tool Suite has a pretty good Spring Starter support and pretty good support for Spring Boot property management, I actually like to show it here. But you can actually do it in different ways. You can do it, so there is start spring.io. Start spring.io, have you ever tried it or have taken a look at it? How many of you have seen Spring Initializer? More of you should. Like, it's really cool. It allows you to build an application very, very easily. You just go in, you create a Maven artifact, you say what capabilities you want, what Spring Boot version you want, and different types of dependencies, right? JPA, whatever. And it pre-populates an artifact with all the dependencies and everything you need to actually run that type of application. So it's really cool. In my case, I want to build a Spring Cloud Stream app. So what I'm going to do, and I want to build it from, as I said, from Spring Tool Suite. So I'm going to call it message sender. And I'm going to give it a group, call it, I don't know, TJUG message sender. Okay. So package is TJUG message sender. Okay. So this is just configuring the artifact. And here I can pick up the version. I will pick up a snapshot version for Spring Boot because I want to grab the latest version of my project. And then I'm going to say Spring Cloud Stream. Stream. And what I want is to build a Kafka application. So I'm going to do stream Kafka. And that's pretty much it. It downloads the artifacts, it creates the project. You see here the POM. The POM uses the starter for Kafka. Spring Cloud Starter Stream Kafka, which actually pulls in Spring Cloud Stream and the Kafka binder. And now that they're on the class path, I can actually go on and create my app. So let me make sure that Kafka runs. It doesn't, so let me start Kafka very quickly. I'm going to clear my data in Kafka because I want to show you that this doesn't only create the application, but it actually, for example, creates the topics as well. Okay, so I have this, and then I have this example. And I can go here and say enable binding. Okay. This is a bit. Needs a bit of time to think. Okay, so it's going to be source. So I'm going to bind the source interface. Right, and the source interface, as I said, is one of the out-of-the-box interfaces. So you can see it here. It has an output channel that I can. And the nice thing about these being interfaces is that it's not only referenceable by name, but it's actually referenceable by instance. So if I outwire an instance of the source and I say output, I will actually retrieve the channel in a type-safe manner. So here I can create, for example, an inbound channel adapter. I'm going to call it source. Going to send a pretty generic message on the output channel. So this might be a little bit confusing when I'm talking, okay, why is it an inbound channel adapter? Basically what we do is what we are saying is that we're going to connect an external source of messages, which is this method, to a channel. Because it's bound externally, it will actually forward whatever it's created by this method to the external channel. So let's start this. I'm just going to run this as a Spring Boot app. Actually, let me just run it from the dashboard. Okay. So this runs and won't see much, but you see that if you're familiar with Kafka, you see that the topic that I want to send messages to, like I get a topic called output that this microservice will send messages to, right? So I can control, for example, where it does actually what it actually binds to. So I can say something like Spring Cloud Stream bindings output destination equals messages, right? And what I'm saying is that I want the external destination, whatever that means on the target middleware, to be messages. If it's a Kafka topic, then it will be the Kafka topic named messages. Right, so it did, and you can see the other topic being created here. often you see this topic called messages created in Kafka. So that's all good, but I actually want to receive some messages too, right? So I'm going to do the same, and I'm going to say, log sync. I'm going to call this a log sync, and I'm going to call it a goose sync. This is log sync. Sorry for being too small. It can control the size of the I don't know. I'm going to create it. So that's good. So I created another project. Okay, this is message sender, sorry. I'm creating another project that's actually receiving messages. So I'm going to say enable binding, but I actually want to receive, so I'm going to use a sync binding here. Binding, and I call it sync class. And I'm just going to say, okay. So I'm going to say, service activator. Service activator is another Spring integration. Another Spring integration annotation, actually another Spring integration component, is basically receive messages from a channel, passes them to the method, and if there is any return value, it forwards it to the output channel. In this case, we're going to just log them. So the input channel is sync.input. Okay. So now the colleague voids log messages. And I'm going to log the string contents. Right?
I have a question.
Sure.
Sync input as an input channel, is that intercepting messages that are going to any sync or a specific one?
The input channel is, so this is it, this, right? This is reading messages from the destination that this particular channel is bound to. By default, okay, it binds to a destination named input, but for this example, I'm going to have to connect it to messages, which was the destination of the other channel.
So are you intercepting messages that are leaving this app, or is it something else?
No, it's actually, I'm bringing messages inside the app.
Okay.
On the input channel. So
can you generate multiple outputs from the same microservice?
Yes, you can have multiple output channels.
How would you define it? Like it's gonna be source like one, source two?
Well, let me just do it very quickly. So we're going to call it, my channels. I don't know. And I can do something like output, and I'm going to call it message channel odds. Message channel events, something like this. And then when I bind it here, it'll be connected to, and it'll be connected actually to two destinations called odds and evens, unless I do what I'm doing here, which was to say, this channel is bound to a destination called messages. And the reason why I want to do that, and I always want to do that, is that obviously if I have two applications talking to each other, they will need to know what is the common destination
what
that they're talking about.
Stream like a byte stream? We want to stream a byte data.
Well, if you want to stream, like, you will still talk through messages, so you can have messages with bytes
like
payload,
byte
for example. Yeah. There is no continuous, like, it doesn't have the concept necessarily of continuous streaming.
So you can just kind of create kind of continuous, like, terabytes. So I would like to do, like, some sort of backup application. Some sort of, so I want to stream, like, a terabyte of byte
It's not trying to address that kind of requirement. There are better models for doing that. That's what I'm saying. It's more message oriented than anything else.
You could stream files with path names, right?
Sure. I mean, if you can pass a path, for example, that a reference, and then you can do it like that. If you want point-to-point streaming, actually, then sure, you can actually have a like two socket endpoints, for example, connect to each other. It works like that. So yeah, this is focusing mostly on discrete messages. So now, okay. So
it
can be anything.
Some serializer, serializer.
Yes. You can actually configure, so you can configure with outbound messages, you can configure a few things. I'm actually going to show you. You can have POJOs, for example. You can specify how they're serialized. You can plug in the serialization strategy. We use Cryo by default, but you can even do things like specify that they can be serialized to JSON or a portable format. And for version 1.1, actually, we're working on making it pretty easy to, for example, use different schema versions, for example, with Avro. So addressing even schema evolution for that. Right now, it's a little bit like, right now, if you want something more flexible, you have to. I mean, you can always write your own serialization strategy. There is a concept called codec, basically, that you can implement, and you can register it with the application. And basically, it handles encoding and decoding. Obviously, you have to have like the same strategy on both ends. So what we're trying to do is kind of making it easier not to have to have the same strategy on both ends and be a little bit more flexible with it. So if I'm doing Spring Cloud Stream bindings, so for example, for this application, I'm going to say the input is message inputs destination equals messages, right? And if I want, for example, to make a resilience, I can even specify a group, right? So I'm going to specify a group as TJUG. So I'm going to go and start the log sync right now. And what I'm expecting is, if everything was OK, I'm expecting to see the messages, to receive the messages sent by the application. And as you see, I see all the messages previously sent and the new ones. So this is what I mean by durability and resilience. You can actually configure, for example, for Kafka, whether you want to read at the start or the end of the topic, right? But in a very simple way, I've written two microservices that talk to each other over Kafka, right? So communicating through strings is exciting, but it's not the most exciting thing that you can do. So how about we use something more elaborate, like a, when did we get kicked out, by the way?
I don't know. Dan, did you hear we have a time limit?
I haven't heard that.
Okay.
There's something after, but they didn't tell us what time.
Okay.
Don't we usually have 2 hours?
So you can create, for example, a POJO, and you say private string greeting, right? And I can create.
The calendar has something in it.
Okay.
Okay.
So. 15
minutes. Ooh. That's tough. Okay, I'll try to do my best. Okay, let's. I'm gonna call it. Okay, so it's gonna say greeting equals greeting. And I'm going to call it reading equals sets meaning hello. Not the same. Because I'm not very creative with my examples. So, okay, so you do this, and then, for example, you have something like this would be, like, if I do it like this, this would be just serialized using cryo and sendable and why. But if I want to have something a little bit more resilient, then I will do something more. I can tell it, for example, to serialize this to JSON. So I can say sync cloud stream bindings output. Let me stop this for a while. Okay, that's I hit debug. Okay. Let me go back to the example. Stream bindings output content type. I can specify content type is application JSON. And it comes with some internal converters that know, for example, that application, when you have a POJO and it's the expected output type is application JSON, it will convert it to a string and basically attach a header, application JSON. It will tell the next microservice in the stack that it's expecting content of that type. So if I start again, I will get this. So if I start the message sender, if I start the log sync, you will see that the output, the data that it's receiving, is basically encapsulated JSON. And let's do, we've seen data flow. So I want, okay. Let me just do a quick example, actually, which is a little bit more interesting, an application of this fact that it passes on the content type and the JSON. So I'm going to do it, and I'm just going to say the processor. I'm going to say a greeting processor. And the greeting processor has, again, stream Kafka. And what it does, it's basically, again, it is, this time it is a processor that has variable binding. It has a processor. A processor is essentially an interface with both an input and an output. So it's really an application that processes data and passes it down the road. So what I want is to be able to read the data that, like, to process POJOs, right? And I don't want to use the same object. I don't want to share classes between my projects. So I'm going to call it this received greeting. And it's a POJO that basically has the same structure as greeting, but it's a different object. And does this. And let's say this is where the stream listener annotation comes in, and it basically says processor input and sent to output. So let's make a few changes here. So I'm going to say that this is a public string, and it's handle. I'm going to call it handle, and I'm calling received greeting. So I'm going to receive the greeting, and I'm going to say return receive greeting to uppercase something. So it basically unwraps and sends the content as a string over the wire. But what I want to notice here is that I'm using a POJO to receive the data and then to process it, right? So let's do this. Okay. So I'm going to do two things here. I'm going to specify that I want to receive data from send on the messages, and I'm gonna send it out. And one of the important things about this is that I'm writing these as project configurations in my application properties file. But this being a Spring Boot application, you can override these values at runtime. And this is one of the big values of these microservices. You can create them with some values that you think of, but you at runtime can actually configure them and talk, make them talk over whatever topics you want.
Bindings.
Output. Destination equals transformed, right? So this goes here, this goes there, and then log sync will have to receive data from transformed, right? So I'm gonna start. I'm gonna start this guy. Oh, right. This is not, you're going to see an exception here coming from Tomcat. Right. Anyway, this happens, this exception here is because all of them being Spring Boot applications start an embedded Tomcat server by themselves. And because I haven't overridden the default port, it actually tries to connect to 8080. That's all what you see there. But what you've seen here is the greeting processor sending data and the log sync basically processing the result of this operation. So, where is it? Process, greeting processor. Ah, this. So it sees, you see basically the result of this. And this was being actually sent over the, this is received from the transform topic. So you see that all the three services chained together, processing data. Data is sent in like as a string, as different formats. It's even sent as a POJO serialized as JSON. That's basically one of the flexible things of it. In terms of like the, as I said, there are a number of properties here that you can configure. You can configure different, like the main challenge here when you build this type of application is, the main challenges are two. One is how do you control, how do you launch a group of, like as you see, I have to launch each application manually, I have to configure each application manually, I have to go and change the input and output destination for each of these applications. What I want is to have a number of pre-built modules that can be launched under the control, like as you've seen in the beginning. And this is what Dataflow does. It launches them. And it translates the definition of the stream, the way I gave it, into configuration parameters that are passed through Spring Boot to these running applications. So this is essentially where the second part of the talk comes in, and it's not the event driven. Hold on. Go to my slides. I want to show my slides. No. Okay, I'm gonna close this. Yeah. Because it doesn't. Okay. So this is basically where Spring Cloud Dataflow steps in, right? And you've seen it at work. You've seen it how it basically orchestrates and launches a number of processes that can talk to each other. When you look at the HTTP and file modules, they are essentially Spring Cloud Stream applications. So you can take a look at them here. Right. This is, for example, the HTTP source. The HTTP source is a more sophisticated version of what I've written previously. So, but it's essentially a Spring MVC application that has a source binding, and upon receiving an HTTP call, it basically just sends it builds a message and sends it to the output channel. That's all what it does. And it's actually a good example of how you can build applications that combine, let's say, traditional web applications, whatever you want, with messaging. The other one, like the file sync, obviously is the same story, nothing very exciting. It's basically receiving data from the sink. It's writing to the to a file, right? And this is, for example, an example of using Spring integration components. I don't have to write something that writes to a file and converts and handles everything. Actually, there is already a file writing message handler down there. In terms of parts, it builds on top of a project, another project from the Spring family, which is Spring Cloud Deployer. And it's basically aiming to provide a common SPI for deploying applications to different types of runtimes. So it uses, essentially what you want is to have the same abstraction, but use it to launch applications either on the local machine, like as I did right now for testing, but also on other platforms, like using the capabilities of the platform. Like for example, YARN, or you can tell Cloud Foundry to launch a number of applications, or you can tell Kubernetes to actually launch a number of processes, or you can tell Mesos. And implementations for these all these platforms actually exist. So when you're looking at something like this, like when you do something like this, Spring Create, and so on and so forth, data flow goes in and says, okay, what does HTTP and file mean? What it does, it's basically looking up for two Uber jars, two resources that represent these two applications. It has a number of pre-registered applications, but you can actually register your own. Like if you have time, I'll probably show you how to do that. If not, actually, there is a webinar that I just gave, but I have this example running on doing that. So after it does that, it goes and says, okay, what common destinations should these two applications talk over? So it finds the destinations, it passes boot parameters, it uses different mechanisms. For example, typically most of these platforms that I'm talking about use environment variables, which is where Spring Boot is very useful. It basically allows you to provide application configuration parameters through environment variables. And at runtime, it says, oh, HTTP, in this particular case, for example, HTTP and file talk over a Kafka topic or Redis queue called http.demo. Actually, demo.http. It's always the name of the sender. It also controls the instance count or resource allocation. So you can say, I want to launch two instances of the file. It controls partitioning. It says, well, I want to use this particular partitioning logic for sending data to these applications. And this is basically kind of the way it looks like, right? It's a number, like the end result is that regardless of the platform that you choose, there is a very, like a common core that talks over this SPI to the platform. And you can actually plug in whatever other platform you can imagine, right? I don't know. You want to use Docker Swarm at some point? Fine. Write an SPI implementation for Docker Swarm, and you can use it with data flow. That's basically the very powerful aspect of it. In terms of developer experience, you've seen the HTTP pipe file, right? Let's build an uppercase transformer if we don't get kicked out. And I'm going to use as much time as I had. I like this. So I'm going to write an uppercase transformer. TJUG transformer. And I'm going to call it OK. And I'm going to call it TJUG transformer. And I'm going to call it OK. And I'm going to use Redis because is 133 because these are compatible with 133. Okay. So I'm going to write this component. And if you're not bored with this already, it's kind of repetitive in a way, but it's quite simple. I'm just going to do enable binding. And I'm going to call it processor. I'm going to use a processor with one input and one output. And I'm going to create it. This time, I'm going to use another Spring integration annotation. I can use the binding listener as well. I'm going to call it a transformer, just to stick with the example that we have in the slides. And I'm going to call it public string transform, the string inbound message, and return inbounds to uppercase. So let me do the completion here. What I'm going to do is I'm going to go and I'm going to go to my website. I'm going to do MPC Transformer. I'm going to install. I'm going to install this in Maven. So the process of actually creating a new module in this iteration involves creating a Maven artifact and deploying it into a repository that's accessible to your to Spring Cloud data flow. So you can configure different repositories if you have, for example, an internal corporate repository with Maven artifacts. But what we want is to actually expand the range of things that we support to other things, like, for example, HDFS or S3, or you can specify an S3 location where the module exists, or so on and so forth. What it wants, essentially, what the end game is retrieving a Spring boot Uber jar and registering with the application. So once I have that, I can go and say, like with Dataflow started, I can go and say, I can say module, and I can say register, and I can call it name, I'll call it uppercase, and I'll call it, it's a processor. And the coordinates are, let me just see very quickly what it is. Just TJUG transformer 001 snapshots. TJUG transformer. The reason why I'm looking is that we use build snapshot for our known builds. So. And so I'm going to register it. And I'm going to say module info uppercase. Okay. It's called processor uppercase. I think yes, I know what it does. It's trying to look remotely, but I have it only locally. So let me just create a stream. Yes, because I'm sorry. Okay, it exists already, so let me create a stream. Normally, this is the normal deployer, like the local deployer, which actually spawns processes on the local machine. This is kind of simulates what would happen in a cloud environment when you want to launch multiple instances. Normally, we don't recommend using the local deployer for anything else. But if you want to get, for example, information about it. So this is a small bug that the module info actually tries to look it up remotely. So I deployed the demo, and let me just post data. So let me just go back to file sync. Right. String.
Well, how would you interpret it? In either case, the interpretation is the same.
Put a bug. So I made a mistake because I was in a hurry. Completion has completely messed up. Okay. So, and apologies for fumbling the previous example. I'm going to rebuild this. I just stole it. I rebuild it, reinstall it. And I'm going to destroy the stream. Sometimes it hangs. So I'm going to recreate the stream with a and deploy it. And sail again and okay. And you can see the yay, it worked. So you can actually see the uppercase transformer actually in place converting data before it's sent to the sink. Unfortunately, I had a mistake in my previous example. I pulled in a different class through autocomplete, so stream actually looked at it, found no channels. It created the module, but then kind of they failed talking to each other. Yes, yes. So actually what you can see is that you can fix your own mistakes quite easily by simply just rebuilding your application and redeploying and redeploying another version of your artifact. If you have this was a snapshot, so it's okay to redeploy another version of your artifact, or you can actually register a different version of your artifact under the same name. So if this was a full deployment, to fix it, I would have to go and register another version of the uppercase transformer and then use that in the stream definition. Mm-hmm. Right. So that's pretty much it. I mean, I think it's a pretty, pretty broad topic, and I mean, there are some other things that you can do there with this. Like, you can apply the pattern that I just show you with publish, subscribe, for example, to create taps, which is streams that listen to other streams and basically process data that's flowing between the different modules. So I could intercept, for example, the transform values and actually use them for other purposes. There is an entire wealth of stuff that relevant out there. I leave a bunch of links here for reference. And, you know, that's all I have. Like, if you have, like, I'm really welcoming any questions you have. And I don't know, if you get kicked out, we can still chat in the other room. It's been a real pleasure to be here. So, questions?
How do you manage all your microservices?
Typically, we use data flow as the as the coordination layer. And in terms of management, we typically rely on the platform to provide, failover or instance control, like instance count control or anything like that.
I guess I meant more from a development perspective, like, you've got hundreds of microservices. How are you keeping track of what formats and what data each one is producing, what it consumes, what it does, what's connected, which microservices are connected to each other?
Right. That's again, in terms, like if you work directly at the Spring Cloud Stream model, then you would have to, like we're trying to, as I mentioned earlier, the earlier question, we really promote portable formats. So if you can have them talk to a format that's interchangeable, like which allows you, for example, not to have to share classes, like JSON, for example, JSON serialization over cryo serialization, that's one thing.
Mm-hmm. That
is true. So for now, you would have to know what you expect on the other end.
Sure.
So you would have to share it. We're working on building more flexible ways of propagating what kind of schema are you using. So. You can use, for example, right now you have an option to use content types for that. So you can specify that a certain message comes in a certain content type, so we have a specific transformer basically being able to do the conversion. But that's a limiting option. I mean, it's flexible, but it's not the most flexible option that you have. Being able to specify, because even if you know, for example, that's oh, that's JSON, it might be version 1 or version 2 or version N on that.
Data
yes.
Over
yes.
The course of your data flow.
Exactly. So we're working on version 1.0, which actually is going to be released next week, relies on you doing the management for that. 1.1, one of the big themes for 1.1 is adding support for propagating version information. With the messages and being able to be a little bit smarter about how you process that type of process those messages. No problem.
Okay. Just wondering, is this like an enterprise service bus type of platform that you're selling? Like, just Spring's version of JMS and enterprise service bus pre-made plugins, that kind of stuff?
So the question was whether is it a Spring's version of enterprise service bus? It's not, but it's a valid question because it's based on Spring integration, which was the non-bus based enterprise integration platform. And I say non-bus based, it was really not relying on a central bus where different applications talk to each other and basically using that as a hub. It's relied on on standalone components and beans talking over channels to each other and kind of promoting, like you don't know whom you are sending the message to, you're just sending it to this particular channel and whoever happens to listen to this particular channel will be the recipient of it. That is the precursor of Stream. You can see it in that sense. What it adds, essentially, it adds a little bit more, more of a Unix pipes and filters feel to it than necessarily the bus model. So it's really small integrating components talking to each other, like kind of cascading over each other and
I'm just thinking like JMS, I could pass POJOs across that, I could pass JSON across that.
JMS is a transport. So JMS is, let's say, the messaging system. This is more of a programming abstraction over a messaging system. It really requires a messaging system to work. So we can have we don't have a JMS binding, and that's mostly because JMS, and generally speaking, when we got to that JMS implementations, like you really get into the JMS implementation details in a lot of cases, but there is a JMS binder. Like there, someone, like a few people ask about ActiveMQ or IBM message queue bindings for binders, right? That actually allow you to use those, to use JMS as a transport for this.
Okay.
So that JMS is a transport, really. But yes, you need a messaging system for sure.
Okay.
For this to work.
I got a question. What would be your approach? Let's say you would like to implement authentication.
Right.
Any plans like from zero calls? So you have like a generic approach, how like so you would like to authenticate your sources?
Well,
or you have to actually to stick to what's the name, like the native approach or underlying technology like Kafka or
Well, for communicating to the middleware itself, you will have to have like the sources will communicate, like we use authentication, for example, to connect to the Rabbit broker or to the Kafka broker or something like that. HTTP endpoints, for example, get authentication courtesy of Spring MVC having authentication capabilities. So really, the beauty of it is that because it integrates the entire Spring ecosystem, you can actually use whatever is available for solving that problem in the Spring ecosystem. You just bring it on top of that.
So one of the difficulties that we had when I worked in Storm, which in some ways is similar, is going from a large disparate set of classes that are often spread over dozens of files to a coherent picture of a data flow.
Right.
Borders on impossible. Right. And so Storm eventually provided that as a view in their web UI or whatever it was, but I was working with it before that point, and really that was one of our biggest challenges, was going, okay, we've written this, but now what the hell is actually talking to what? Is
sure.
there any, like, any way to get even a textual output of, you know, here are all of the connections from what to what?
I don't have it running on my machine, but let me just take a look. Spring, there are two, yeah, Spring Data
okay.
Flow. So, flow, let's see, if there is, if I can find flow. Okay, I should forward, I will include the link to
sure.
this. So there are three things that that you want to take a look at in with regards to this, where we, I think we can help. 93, 93, and then. So on one hand, there is an admin UI
okay.
that somehow allows you to visualize the streams that we just declared and their structure.
Okay.
But there is another UI which is not included in this, is in development right now.
Sure.
I was hoping to get at least a video of it and demo. We have some public links, but I don't have them with me right now,
sure.
Which is called Flow. And it actually visualizes, like it's a graphic visualization of how the streams actually operate and what's their structure. You can actually use it as an editor for your streams.
Okay.
And there is a third, option, which is not necessarily related to your question, but actually Jonathan has suggested me right now, and it's Zipkin, which is our distributed tracing. Actually, Zipkin is not ours, it's Twitter's, but we integrated through it through Spring Cloud Sleuth, which is, so that basically allows you to monitor, for example, the messages as they pass through the system and even reconstruct the message history across the system. You can say, well, this message going through the source is actually having this, like really has passed through these endpoints and it has spent so much time in here. So you can actually do this type of management and monitoring.
Cool.
I'm sorry? What was, sorry.
If
so the
happened to a channel between
right.
Software and some application, you you are big related or another application will be created, how you acknowledge messages.
Right. So the question was, if something happens to a channel between messages, between modules, what do we deal? Basically, my question is, how do we deal with different errors, like communicating to that? So first and foremost, you have to see that each application has its own channel, and they talk over, like they talk to the remote broker. Therefore, if the broker goes down, then we have different strategies. One is, obviously you're not going to be able to send messages. If there are errors inside the module, for example, we can do a couple of things. One is that you can bind the error channel. There's an error channel, which is optionally bound, so you can channel that, like those errors, to another. Like to another queue where you receive them. If there are communication errors, there are like the system has a retry capability in there. So basically, we'll essentially try to deliver the messages until it actually the options are exhausted. It has the option of like if the middleware, for example, supports transactions in a form or another, it has the ability of you have different acknowledgement models. So you can say, you can acknowledge manually, you can have them, you can even have them transacted, for example, with Rabbit. So you would say, well, I've read this message. Obviously, if you can't connect, like if you can't send it to Rabbit because the broker is down, you can't read the message either, right? So, yeah, so if you have that kind of thing, then you could prevent the acknowledgement of the message in face of an error and stuff like that. So you have different strategies for handling. You can configure that. You can configure whether it's put back into the queue or it's sent to a dead letter queue. So these are already part of the, let's say, more middleware specific configuration. Depends. It's also a function of how sophisticated the middleware is and what it can do. Like some middlewares allow you to dead letter it. Some others put it back into the queue. Some others allow you to ignore it if it's a poison message, right? You can avoid that. No problem.
One more? Last question?
One more? Yes. So the question was, if there is an error, can you control how many times? Like you can, how many times you retry? Yes. You can actually control the retry policy. So you can say, for example, you can set the backoff time for each message. So you can say, for example, that you want to retry 5 times, but you want to increase the interval between each try. Repeat. Right. So that's again. Stuff, something that you can configure. You can do something like this in here. Essentially, let me just. As I can name, you can say spring, cloud, stream, bindings, inputs. Consumer. Max attempts, for example. Sorry, you cannot see it, but there is a max attempts parameter which says 9. I'm gonna try. And backoff policy is like an interval increases by so and so many numbers. So yeah, these are already built in, so to speak.
Cool. Thank you.
Well, thank you. Thank you for attending. Thanks.